Chapter 6, DNA Replication, Repair, and Recombination. The ability of a cell to maintain order in a chaotic environment depends on the accurate duplication of the vast quantity of genetic information carried in its DNA. This duplication process, called DNA replication, must occur before a cell can produce two genetically identical daughter cells. Maintaining order in a cell also requires the continual surveillance and repair of its genetic information. As DNA is subject to damage by chemicals and radiation from the environment, and by reactive molecules that are generated inside the cell. In this chapter, we describe the protein machines that replicate and repair the cell's DNA. These machines catalyze some of the most rapid and accurate processes that take place within cells, and their actions reflect the elegance and efficiency of cell chemistry. Despite these systems for protecting the genetic instructions from copying errors and accidental damage, permanent changes or mutations sometimes do occur. Although many mutations do not affect the organism in any noticeable way, some have profound consequences. Occasionally, these changes can benefit the organism. For example, mutations can make bacteria resistant to antibiotics that are used to kill them. Indeed, the accumulation of changes in DNA over millions of years provides the variety in genetic material that makes one species distinct from another, as we discuss in Chapter 9. Mutations also produce the smaller variations that underlie many of the differences between individuals of the same species that we can easily see in humans and other animals. Figure 6.1. However, mutations can also be detrimental. In humans, they are responsible for thousands of inherited diseases and for many types of cancer. Thus, the survival of a cell or organism depends on keeping changes in its DNA to a minimum. Without the cellular systems that are continually monitoring and repairing damage to DNA, it is questionable whether life could exist at all. We begin this chapter by reviewing the mechanisms that are responsible for copying and maintaining DNA with minimal changes. We next consider some of the intriguing ways in which genetic information can be altered, including homologous recombination and the movement of the special DNA sequences in our chromosomes called mobile genetic elements. Finally, we consider viruses, little more than genes protected by a protein coat, which can move from cell to cell. DNA replication. At each cell division, a cell must copy its genome with extraordinary accuracy. In this section, we explore how the cell achieves this feat while duplicating DNA at rates as high as 1,000 nucleotides per second. Base pairing enables DNA replication. In the preceding chapter, we saw that each strand of the DNA double helix contains a sequence of nucleotides that is exactly complementary to the nucleotide sequence of its partner strand. Each strand can therefore act as a template or mold for the synthesis of a new complementary strand. Figure 6.2. In other words, if we designate the two DNA strands as S and S prime, strand S can serve as a template for making a new strand S prime, while strand S prime can serve as a template for making a new strand S. Figure 6.3. Thus, the genetic information in DNA can be accurately copied by the beautifully simple process in which strand S separates from strand S prime, and each separated strand then serves as a template for the production of a new complementary partner strand that is identical to its former partner. The ability of each strand of a DNA molecule to act as a template for producing a complementary strand enables the cell to copy or replicate its genes before passing them on to its descendants. But the task is awe-inspiring, as it can involve copying billions of nucleotide pairs every time a cell divides. The copying must be carried out with speed and accuracy. In about 8 hours, a dividing animal cell will copy the equivalent of 1,000 books like this one, and on average, get no more than a letter or two wrong. This feat is performed by a cluster of proteins that together form a replication machine. DNA replication produces two complete double helices from the original DNA molecule, each new DNA helix identical, except for rare copying errors in nucleotide sequence to the parental DNA double helix. See Figure 6.3. Because each parental strand serves as a template for one new strand, each of the daughter DNA double helices ends up with one of the original old strands plus one strand that is completely new. This style of replication is said to be semi-conservative. Figure 6.4. In How We Know, pages 200 to 202, we discuss the experiments that first demonstrated that DNA is replicated in this way. DNA synthesis begins at replication origins. The DNA double helix is normally very stable. The two DNA strands are locked together firmly by the large numbers of hydrogen bonds between the bases on both strands. See figure 5.2. As a result, only temperatures approaching those of boiling water provide enough thermal energy to separate these strands. To be used as a template, however, the double helix must first be opened up and the two strands separated to exposed unpaired bases. How does this occur at the temperatures found in living cells? The process of DNA replication is begun by initiator proteins that bind to the DNA and pry the two strands apart, breaking the hydrogen bonds between the bases. Figure 6.5. Although the hydrogen bonds collectively make the DNA helix very stable, individually each hydrogen bond is weak, as discussed in Chapter 2. Separating a short length of DNA a few base pairs at a time therefore does not require a large energy input, and it can occur with the assistance of these proteins at normal temperatures. The positions at which the DNA is first opened are called replication origins, and they are usually marked by a particular sequence of nucleotides. In simple cells, such as those of bacteria or yeast, replication origins span approximately 100 nucleotide pairs. They are composed of DNA sequences that attract the initiator proteins, as well as stretches of DNA that are especially easy to open. We saw in Chapter 5 that an AT base pair is held together by fewer hydrogen bonds than is a GC base pair. Therefore, DNA rich in AT base pairs is relatively easy to pull apart, and AT rich stretches of DNA are typically found at replication origins. A bacterial genome, which is typically contained in a circular DNA molecule of several million nucleotide pairs, has a single replication origin. The human genome, which is very much larger, has approximately 10,000 such origins. In humans, beginning DNA replication at many places at once greatly shortens the time a cell needs to copy its entire genome. Once an initiator protein binds to DNA at the replication origin and locally opens up the double helix, it attracts a group of proteins that carry out DNA replication. These proteins form a protein machine, with each member of the group carrying out a specific function. We will introduce each of them shortly, after we present an overview of the process of DNA replication. New DNA synthesis occurs at replication forks. DNA molecules in the process of being replicated contain Y-shaped junctions called replication forks. Figure 6.9. At these forks, the replication machine moves along the DNA, opening up the two strands of the double helix and using each strand as a template to make a new daughter strand. Two replication forks are formed at each replication origin, and they move away from the origin in opposite directions, unzipping the DNA as they go. DNA replication in bacterial and eukaryotic chromosomes is therefore termed bidirectional. The forks move very rapidly, at about 1,000 nucleotide pairs per second in bacteria and 100 nucleotide pairs per second in humans. The slower rate of fork movement in humans, indeed in all eukaryotes, may be due to the difficulties in replicating DNA through the more complex chromatin structure found in these organisms. At the heart of the replication machine is an enzyme called DNA polymerase, which synthesizes new DNA using one of the old strands as a template. This enzyme catalyzes the addition of nucleotides to the 3' end of a growing DNA strand by forming a phosphodiester bond between this end and the 5' phosphate group of the incoming nucleotide. Figure 6.10. Nucleotides enter the reaction initially as nucleoside triphosphates, which provide the energy for polymerization. The hydrolysis of one high-energy bond in the nucleoside triphosphate fuels the reaction that links the nucleotide monomer to the chain and releases pyrophosphate, PP subscript I. The DNA polymerase couples the release of this energy to the polymerization reaction. Pyrophosphate is further hydrolyzed to inorganic phosphate, P subscript I, which makes a polymerization reaction effectively irreversible. See figure 341. DNA polymerase does not dissociate from the DNA each time it adds a new nucleotide to the growing chain. Rather, it stays associated with the DNA and moves along the template strand stepwise for many cycles of the polymerization reaction. Movie 6.1 shows a DNA polymerase molecule in action. We will see later in this chapter that a special protein keeps the polymerase attached to the DNA as it repeatedly adds new nucleotides to the growing chain. The replication fork is asymmetrical. The 5' to 3' direction of the DNA polymerization mechanism poses a problem at the replication fork. We saw in figure 5.2 that the sugar phosphate backbone of each strand of a DNA double helix has a unique chemical direction, or polarity, determined by the way each sugar residue is linked to the next, and that the two strands in a double helix run in opposite directions. As a consequence, at the replication fork, one new DNA strand is being made on a template that runs in one direction, 3' to 5', whereas the other new strand is being made on a template that runs in the opposite direction, 5' to 3'. Figure 6.11. The replication fork is therefore asymmetrical. At first glance, both of the new DNA strands appear to be growing in the same direction, that is, the direction in which the replication fork is moving. On the face of it, this suggests that one strand is being synthesized in the 3' to 5' direction, and one is being synthesized in the 5' to 3' direction. DNA polymerase, however, can catalyze the growth of the DNA chain in only one direction. It can add new subunits only to the 3' end of the chain. See figure 6.10. As a result, a new DNA chain can be synthesized only in a 5' to 3' direction. This can easily account for the synthesis of one of the two strands of DNA at the replication fork, but not the other. One might have expected a second type of DNA polymerase to synthesize the other DNA strand, one that works by adding subunits to the 5' end of a DNA chain. However, no such enzyme exists. Instead, the problem is solved by the use of a backstitching maneuver. The DNA strand whose 5' end must grow is made discontinuously, in successive separate small pieces, with the DNA polymerase moving backward with respect to the direction of the replication fork as each new piece is made in the 5' to 3' direction. The resulting small DNA pieces, called Okazaki fragments, after the biochemist who discovered them, are later joined together to form a continuous new strand. Figure 6.12. The DNA strand that is synthesized discontinuously in this way is called the lagging strand. The other strand, which is synthesized continuously, is called the leading strand. Although they differ in subtle details, the replication forks of all cells, prokaryotic and eukaryotic, have leading and lagging strands. This common feature arises from the fact that all DNA polymerases work in the 5' to 3' direction only. An important advantage of this seemingly complicated molecular maneuver is discussed next. DNA polymerase is self-correcting. DNA polymerase is so accurate that it makes only about one error in every 10 to the power of 7 nucleotide pairs it copies. This error rate is much lower than can be explained simply by the accuracy of complementary base pairing. Although AT and GC are by far the most stable base pairs, other, less stable base pairs, for example GT and CA, can also be formed. Such incorrect base pairs are formed much less frequently than correct ones, but if allowed to remain, they would kill the cell through an accumulation of mutations. This catastrophe is avoided because DNA polymerase has two special qualities that greatly increase the accuracy of DNA replication. First, the enzyme carefully monitors the base pairing between each incoming nucleotide and the template strand. Only when the match is correct does DNA polymerase catalyze the nucleotide addition reaction. Second, when DNA polymerase makes a rare mistake and adds the wrong nucleotide, it can correct the error through an activity called proofreading. Proofreading takes place at the same time as DNA synthesis. Before the enzyme adds the next nucleotide to a growing DNA chain, it checks whether the previous nucleotide is correctly base paired to the template strand. If so, the polymerase adds the next nucleotide. If not, the polymerase clips off the mispaired nucleotide and tries again. Figure 6.13. Thus, DNA polymerase possesses a highly accurate 5' to 3' polymerization activity, as well as a 3' to 5' proofreading activity. This proofreading is carried out by a nuclease that cleaves the phosphodiester backbone. Polymerization and proofreading are tightly coordinated, and the two reactions are carried out by different domains within the polymerase molecule. Figure 6.14. This proofreading mechanism explains why DNA polymerases synthesize DNA only in the 5' to 3' direction. Despite the need that this imposes for a cumbersome backstitching mechanism at the replication fork, as shown in Figure 6.15a, a hypothetical DNA polymerase that synthesized in the 3' to 5' direction and would thereby circumvent the need for backstitching would be unable to proofread. If it removed an incorrectly paired nucleotide, the polymerase would create a chain and that is chemically dead, in the sense that it could no longer be elongated. Thus, for a DNA polymerase to function as a self-correcting enzyme that removes its own polymerization errors as it moves along the DNA, it must proceed only in the 5' to 3' direction. Figure 6.15b. Short lengths of RNA act as primers for DNA synthesis. We have seen that the accuracy of DNA replication depends on the requirement of the DNA polymerase for a correctly base-paired end before it can add more nucleotides. But because the polymerase can join a nucleotide only to a base pair nucleotide in a DNA double helix, it cannot start a completely new DNA strand. A different enzyme is needed, one that can begin a new polynucleotide chain simply by joining two nucleotides together without the need for a base paired end. This enzyme does not, however, synthesize DNA. It makes a short length of a closely related type of nucleic acid, RNA, ribonucleic acid, using the DNA strand as a template. This short length of RNA, about 10 nucleotides long, is base paired to the template strand and provides a base paired 3' end as a starting point for a DNA polymerase. It thus serves as a primer for DNA synthesis, and the enzyme that synthesizes the RNA primer is known as primase. Primase is an example of an RNA polymerase, an enzyme that synthesizes RNA using DNA as a template. A strand of RNA is very similar chemically to a single strand of DNA, except that it is made of ribonucleotide subunits, in which the sugar is ribose, not deoxyribose. RNA also differs from DNA in that it contains the base uracil, U, instead of thymine, T. See panel 2-6, pages 74 to 75. However, because U can form a base pair with A, the RNA primer is synthesized on the DNA strand by complementary base pairing in exactly the same way as is DNA. For the leading strand, an RNA primer is needed only to start replication at a replication origin. Once a replication fork has been established, the DNA polymerase is continuously presented with a base paired 3' end as it tracks along the template strand. But on the lagging strand, where DNA synthesis is discontinuous, new primers are needed continually. See figure 6.12. As the movement of the replication fork exposes a new stretch of unpaired bases, a new RNA primer is made at intervals along the lagging strand. DNA polymerase adds a deoxyribonucleotide to the 3' end of this primer to start a DNA strand, and it will continue to elongate the strand until it runs into the next RNA primer. Figure 6.16. To produce a continuous new DNA strand from the many separate pieces of nucleic acid made on the lagging strand, three additional enzymes are needed. These act quickly to remove the RNA primer, replace it with DNA, and join the DNA fragments together. Thus, a nuclease breaks apart the RNA primer. A DNA polymerase, called a repair polymerase, then replaces this RNA with DNA, using the end of the adjacent Okazaki fragments as a primer. And the enzyme DNA ligase joins the 5' phosphate end of one new DNA fragment to the adjacent 3' hydroxyl end of the next. See figure 6.16. Primase can begin new polynucleotide chains, but this activity is possible because the enzyme does not proofread its work. As a result, primers contain a high frequency of mistakes, but because primers are made of RNA instead of DNA, they stand out as suspect copy to be automatically removed and replaced by DNA. This DNA is put in by DNA repair polymerases, which, like the replicative polymerases, proofread as they synthesize. In this way, The cell's replication machinery is able to begin new DNA chains and at the same time ensure that all of the DNA is copied faithfully. Proteins at a replication fork cooperate to form a replication machine. As mentioned earlier, DNA replication requires a variety of proteins acting in concert. Here we discuss the proteins that, together with DNA polymerase and primase, form the protein machine that powers a replication fork forward and synthesizes new DNA behind it. For DNA synthesis to proceed, the double helix must be unzipped ahead of the replication fork so that the incoming deoxyribonucleoside triphosphates can form base pairs with the template strand. Two types of replication proteins, DNA helicases and single-strand binding proteins, cooperate to carry out this task. At the very front end of the replication machine is a helicase, a protein that uses the energy of ATP hydrolysis to pry apart the double helix as it speeds along the DNA. Figure 617A in movie 6.2. The single-strand binding protein clings to the single-stranded DNA exposed by the helicase, transiently preventing it from reforming base pairs and keeping it in an elongated form so that it can readily serve as a template for DNA polymerase.